F and P1. And we are going to simplify this thing right here. So everybody knows X is on the top, cancel with X is on the bottom, right? And if they're not the same amount of X's, there's going to be some leftover ones somewhere. So I've got three X's on the top and two X's on the bottom. Obviously, I have one extra X on the top. So when I write my answer, I'm going to have an X on the top. Now let's look at the Y's. I have four Y's on the top, five Y's on the bottom. Obviously, some are going to cancel out, but I have one extra one, and it is on the bottom. Oh my gosh, this is so easy. All right, now let's take a look at this one. We threw in a negative exponent. So Kafka is going like this, right? Where's my, has everybody signed my scene chart?
No.
Okay, let's make sure it gets all signed. And then whoever's the last one, if you bring it up to me, that'd be great so I can start calling people. When you have a negative exponent, it flips the fraction. So the first thing you're probably going to want to do is flip your fraction. Negative exponents move things from the top to the bottom and vice versa. So since that negative is on the whole fraction, the whole thing is going to flip. Now, when you square a fraction, that means you square the top and you square the bottom. So on the top, we're going to have what? X squared, Y squared. And on the bottom, we're going to have
9.
Done, right? Now, let's look at this one. Now, there are X's on the top and X's on the bottom, and you might want to start canceling, but you can't. You can't start canceling until you deal with this parentheses. Remember that order of operations thing that you learned when you were a little kid, and I don't know if you learned it as PEMDAS or please excuse my dear Aunt Sally. What's first? Parentheses. If you've got parentheses, you need to deal with those first, always. So let's take care of that. So I have a quantity that's being squared. That means that everything in there is being squared. So this right here, just this part right here, is going to become what? 16x to the 4th. Now, I don't want you ever getting confused about raising a power to a power. Yes, you multiply the exponents, but sometimes we forget, because sometimes we add exponents, sometimes we multiply them. Remember, you can always, always, always write it out if you need to. So x squared squared means x squared times x squared, doesn't it? And that means xx, xx. So what have I got? X to the 4th. So if I forget my rules, I can always just write it out, and that will give me the right answer. All right, well, back to the problem. I got 16x to the 4th, y to the 5th over 4x squared. So now I'm going to start canceling things out. You notice on the top you have a 16, and on the bottom you have a 4. Now that reduces. What is it reduced to?
4.
On the top. 16's on the top. The big number's on the top. So when you do the canceling, you're going to be left with a 4 on the top. Right? 4 over 1, but we don't normally write the 1. Now, I've got four X's on the top and two X's on the bottom. So I'm going to be left with two on the top. I've got five Y's on the top, two Y's on the bottom. Oh, no, no Y's on the bottom. I've got five Y's on the top. So there's my answer. We're done. All right, now look at this next one. Oh my gosh, what a scary mess, but it's really easy. Remember what negative exponents do? They move you. Negative exponents move you. Okay, now this negative exponent is only on the x. So the whole fraction's not flipping, just the x is coming to the bottom. So he was an x to the negative second on the top. Now he's an x squared on the bottom. He's going to come down. What about this guy? He's going to do the same thing. Now, what about that z right there? He's going to stay right where he is. What about that x to the fourth right there? He stays. How about that y to the negative fifth? He's going up. Negative exponents change your position in the fraction. So if you're negative on the bottom, you're going to the top. If you're negative on the top, you're coming to the bottom. What about z to the sixth? What do I do with him? He stays there, right? So now I've dealt with all my negative exponents, and I can start putting things together and canceling things out. So let's see. On the bottom, I notice I have an x squared and an x to the fourth. Now think about that for a second. Forget the rules and just think about it. You have two x's and you have four x's. So what do you got?
Six.
Six X's, that's right. So we have X to the sixth on the bottom. We took care of those two. Now, what about these Y's? Let's take a look at our Y's. I have five on the top and three on the bottom.
Two.
So that's going to be two on the top. Take care of those guys. All right, now let's look at our Z's. I have one on the top and six on the bottom. So that leaves me with five on the bottom.
Can you just add them when they're negative like that?
Uh-huh.
So instead of flipping.
Well, actually, if you've got one over the other, it actually would be a subtraction problem. Or you can think of, so it's negative two minus four, which is x to the negative six, which means you got six of them on the bottom. Or you can just think about, hey, I've got these two are coming down.
Yeah.
There's already four down there. That makes a total of six. Okay, now we've got this guy. See that cube right there? That means everything gets cubed. Now just think about it. That means I have x squared, x squared, x squared. So how many x's is that? If I have two of them, two of them, two of them, someone said eight, let's count again. We have two of them, two of them, two of them. So that would be six. This is x to the sixth. This means x squared, x squared, x squared. Think about it. Two of them, two of them, two of them. That's x to the sixth. Now here's where we sometimes screw up. This is not a nine. What goes on the bottom? 27. You are cubing. 3 cubed. That means 3 times 3 times 3. Alright. Oh, here we've got another negative. Notice that negative's just like this one. It's on the whole thing. So what do?
Flip it
and make it x over 2 squared.
I square it.
Very good. X squared over 4. X squared over 4. All right, anybody have a question about that? All right, at the end of the period, we're going to do another practice one. Because on Monday, we're going to have a little quizzy too. Okay, well, we're going to practice, but right now we're going to move on. So here we go, next section. And boys, you should have these notes. I think it starts with part 8. So you're good.
Wait, so
you
don't have.
Yes, they
do.
If you have questions, you can ask them.
Do you have like time?
Yeah, you just say this word and it needs to be problem, whatever.
Okay.
All right, so here we go. Number 8 says we're going to write in scientific notation. Okay? We're going to write in scientific notation. Remember how this works? We did this in chemistry a lot.
Decimal point.
It involves moving the decimal point. And the rule is, that the number that you write, well, I'll just do this one, is 3.14683 times 10 to the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So the rule is that the number, whatever number you have here, times 10 to the power, that number has to be between 1 and 9, or 1 and 10. That number has to be between 1 and 10. So I know that the decimal point has to be moved all the way over to here. That's the only place the decimal could be, because this number has to be between 1 and 10. Now, why is it 10 to the 5th? Well, I had to move the decimal point 5 places to get it in the right spot. So that's why it's 10 to the 5th. I just counted. Now, the next one, if you're going to write this in scientific notation, isn't that decimal point going to have to be here?
Yeah.
Because again, that number has to be between 1 and 10. 0.7 is not between 1 and 10. 71 is not between 1 and 10. The only place the decimal could go is right here. So it's 7.136 times 10 to the
-1.
Now, I remember when I was in school, oh my gosh, my teacher kept trying all these rules about, okay, if you go this direction, it's positive, if you go this direction, it's negative. Yeah. Kids, it's way simpler than that. If you have a big number, your exponent is always going to be positive. If you have a little number, like 0.7, your exponent is going to be negative. Every time. You don't have, I mean, if you want to memorize, I moved left or moved right, that's fine, but you don't need to. Now, part 9 is asking us to do more work with scientific notation, but to actually, do some operations with it. So let's talk about how we might do this problem. Did anyone bring a calculator today?
Yeah.
Good. Did you get that out? Because we're going to need it.
We need a graphing one, right?
Yep, okay. We sure did.
Can we use a non-graphing one until we get
on graphing? Sure. Alright, so here we go, because here we don't need a graphing calculator, we just need something to multiply for us. So does everybody recognize we got 3 numbers here in scientific notation? And we're going to simplify this. And in order to simplify it, we're going to deal with the numbers first. Okay, we're going to deal with these first. Scientific notation is 2 parts. You got the number and you got the 10. We're going to deal with all the numbers first. What do you think we're going to do with these 2 numbers?
Multiply.
So would somebody do that with a calculator? 3.16 times 1.43.
4.5188.
And then what do you think we're going to do with this guy? Divide. So go ahead and take that number and divide.
3.6738.
That should stop right there. Okay, now, did everybody understand where that number came from? We took these 2 and multiplied them, because they're being multiplied together, and then we divided by this one. Everybody okay with that? So now I got to take care of the tens. All right, now look. Remember, what happens when you have negative exponents? They move, right? So this is going to be times 10 to the 8th on the bottom, and this is going to be times 10 to the 10th on the top. Would you agree?
Yeah.
So let's look at the top. On the top, we have 5 tens, and now we have 10 tens, which gives me a total of
15
tens on the top. But there are 8 tens on the bottom.
For 7?
Times 10 to the 7th. Very, very good. Very good. So let's go through that again, make sure everybody's got it. On the top, I have 5 of them and 10 of them. That makes 15. So on the top, I have 15 tens. So think of that. 10, 10, 10, 10, 10, 15 times. On the bottom, I have 8 of them. So you got 15 up here and 8 down here. Aren't these all going to cancel?
Yeah.
And leave you with 7 left over. right, here we go. 3.85 times 10 to the 10th times 4.96 times 10 to the 13th. Well, this looks easier, but actually it's got a tricky component to it. Hang on. How do you think we're going to start? What are we going to do first? We're multiplying, all right? So somebody, you got your calculator, guys. What do you get when you multiply these two numbers together? 19.096 times 10 to the, now look, you got 10 of them, and you got 13 of them.
23.
Times 10 to the 23. Now we're sitting back thinking, hey, that's easy. We have a problem. What's our problem? We have a big problem. Mensur? This number's not right. You can't have a 19 there. Remember, the rule for scientific notation is the number has to be between 1 and 10. So I'm going to have to move that decimal, 1.9096 times 10. Now, obviously, if I move the decimal one place, that's going to change by 1, right? I want you to think about something. Did this number right here, when you made that change, did this guy, this new number, is he bigger or littler than the original?
Littler.
He's littler. If these are going to be equal, if you made this part of the problem littler, you're going to have to make this part of the problem bigger. Because otherwise the numbers won't be the same. These have to be the same number. So if you made the first half smaller, the second half is going to have to get bigger. Okay? Let's try it. Let's try it.
So why don't you distribute on those ones? Like, why would you not, like, 10 to the 4.96?
Okay, well, first of all, if you're going to do the distributive property, you have to have an addition or a subtraction. And when you don't distribute, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so this is not in your notes. Let's just over to the side. Let's just do another one. How about 5.83 times 10 to the negative 17 times 6.45 times 10 to the second? All right, so let's try this. Let's see if we can do this one. So what do we do first? We multiply the numbers, and so what do I get?
37.6035.
All right. Times 10 to the, okay, now wait, I got a negative 17 and a 2.
It's over 10 to the 15th.
So it's going to be over 10 to the 15th, but in scientific notation, we leave it as 10 to the negative 15th. Bad news. Bad news, too big. So 3.76035. Now watch it here. This part of the number went down.
So negative 14?
So this is going to go up. Very good, Brittany. It goes up to negative 14. Remember, in negative numbers, bigger than negative 15 would be negative 14. Awesome. Awesome, awesome, awesome. Yeah. All right, here we go. Number 10. Which property is illustrated? There are a ton of properties that over the years you have learned. We're going to focus in on just a few most primary ones. So anybody know what property is visible in A? That's the distributive property. 10A is distributive. Now look at the rest of them. Do you have any idea what's going on in the rest of them?
The inverse multiplicative property.
But G is the multiplicative inverse. This is the multiplicative, and you can abbreviate, multiplicative inverse. When you multiply inverses, they cancel out. So 1/3 times 3 cancels. That's the multiplicative inverse. All right, anybody want to recognize, or anybody recognize another one? F is the multiplicative identity. Very good. F is the multiplicative identity. And what that means is, when you multiply by 1, you get the identical thing back again. That's the multiplicative identity. Very good.
Associative.
So D is...
Which?
Is it E?
E is associative because everything stayed in the same order, but we regrouped it. So that's the associative property of multiplication. Remember, when you regroup, that's associative. Think about when you associate with your friends, you group yourself. You're in the same group. That's what this is about. If you regroup, you reassociate. And what we did was, instead of grouping the 4 and the 3, we grouped the 6 and the 4. That's associative. You guys are doing great. Can you see another one?
Is D the
additive identity? D is the additive identity. When you add 0, you get the same number. In multiplication, you multiply by 1. In addition, you add 0. Good. You know H. You know what H is. If you can't tell it the way it's written, look at it backwards.
It's distributive.
H is distributive. Kids, we talked about this yesterday. The distributive property goes both ways. You either put a number into the parentheses or you can pull it out. So H is also distributive. That leaves us with what? Just B and C?
Inverse, transitive. They're the same.
Well, B and C are the same basic property because what's happened in both of them? The order has changed. Notice in B, it's x plus y on one side and it's y plus x on the other side. When you change the order, what property is that?
Commutative.
B is the commutative property. I'll write the word out, but you can abbreviate it. The commutative property of addition. And we added in a different order. We added the same two things, x and y, but on one side it was x plus y, on the other side it was y plus x. Got it? No. C is also commutative. Only it's commutative of multiplication. Because on one side, it's 6 times the parentheses, and on the other side, it's the parentheses times 6. So C is the commutative property of multiplication. There is no transitive on here. A couple of you were trying to do transitive. The transitive property, I'll just tell you, says something like, if P equals Q and Q equals M, then P equals M. It is an if-then statement. If you're going to be doing transitive, you're going to have an if-then statement. We have trigonometric proofs, yes. But they're done differently than regular geometry. I mean, we don't like, it's not like this.
Okay.
It's not like that. All right. Okay. All right, so what properties are you responsible for knowing? Distributive?
Identity.
And you need to know it both ways. You need to know your identities, which are adding 0 and timesing by 1. You need to know your inverses, and this is multiplicative inverse. Remember what they tell you, they cancel each other out, right? For the additive inverse, it would be something like 6 plus negative 6 is 0. That's the additive inverse. We talked about it the other day in terms of being the opposite. That's the additive inverse. You need to know your associative property. What happens in an associative problem? No. You do not change the order. If it is associative, 643, the order stays the same. What changes is the grouping, the parentheses. Associative associates. Now, if you want to change order, then you're going to do your commutative. Commutative change order. Okay, those are the five properties you need to know. The distributive, the inverses, the identities, commutative, and associative.
Is that on the big board?
It might be. We're going to do a practice quiz in a little bit.
Okay. Yeah, keep an eye on the time. All these different times.
Okay. All right, let's try P2. Let's start P2. Here we go. Notice I just drawn some lines and some arrows, and you're just going to give me the vocabulary. So does anybody know what might go in any of those blanks?
X-axis, y-axis,
okay, wait a second. Let me catch up. So this right here is the x-axis. And this right here is the y-axis. All right, what else? What's this point right here called?
Origin.
That's called the origin. These four sections here are called quadrants.
Quadrant 1, 2, 3, 4.
Okay, now just remember that's the way it works. This board didn't make it up. Somebody a long time ago did, and that's just how we do it. 1, 2, 3, 4. The whole thing. Does anybody know what this thing is called?
The whole thing?
Yeah, what is this called? It's called the Cartesian coordinate plane. That is exactly right. The Cartesian coordinate plane, named for one of the great mathematicians of all time, Rene Descartes. The Cartesian coordinate plane.
Will that be a bonus question?
It might be. Hadn't thought about it, but it's a good idea. All right. Is anybody confused about any of that? Everybody's okay with that.
What are the axis of symmetry?
The axis of symmetry? Curves often have an axis of symmetry. That is not part of the coordinate plane. It would be if you had a situation like this where you had a parabola, this would be the axis of symmetry. Yeah. All right, here we go. Now we're down to something really big and important. Anybody have any idea what this means? What am I asking you to do? These are ordered pairs.
Well, I like 7 plus 1 is 4 plus 3.
Okay, now we can find slope. That question wouldn't look like this. It would say, what's the slope of AB? And you could do that.
Midpoint.
If we wanted midpoint, it would say, find the midpoint of AB.
Distance.
It's the distance. This means the distance from A to B. All right. Now, in order to find the distance, we need to remember something called the distance formula. It's the one with the big radical.
Oh, dang.
Oh, four.
That's parabola.
It's like parentheses x minus x parentheses squared plus parentheses y minus y parentheses squared.
Where's my seating chart? Who are you again?
Trent.
Trent, you are an amazing human being. Good work. He didn't put the subscripts on, but I will. They're not meant to confuse you. He said, you take your two X's and you subtract them. It doesn't matter which order you subtract them. You just take your two X's and subtract them. So in my problem, my two X's are -1 and 7. So I'll take 7 minus -1. It doesn't matter what order you do it, because you're going to square your answer. All right, and then he said, let's subtract our y's. All right, so my y's are 1 minus 3, and I'm going to square that. Does this look at all familiar to you? Right? We're saying, oh yeah, I know how to do this. All right, so what's 7 minus negative 1? Let's challenge your brains a little bit. That's 8. What is 1 minus 3?
Negative 2.
All right, so here we go. Now, and I'm putting down more steps than you need to. If you want to go straight to 64 plus 4, I am so good with that. That would be the square root of 68. What? You have to break it down. Who said that? Good work. We got to break it down. Now, does every number in the whole wide world break down?
No.
But this one does. And if it breaks down, you got to do it. So, when I say break it down, I do not mean type in square root of 68 on my calculator and come up with 8 point blah, blah, blah. No.
2 root 17.
I mean simplify the radical, which is 2 root 17. Now, I don't know if Brittany did that on her calculator or if she did it like a real mathematician. I need her to do it like a real mathematician. So when we do that, do you remember that
start
doing that tree diagram? That's right. You just break it right down.
No, it's Gale.
Whatever you want to do, call it. But you break it down, or break it out, whatever you do. And if you have 2 of them, that means you put that outside, and if you only have 1 of them, it has to stay
in jail.
So that's how she got that. All right, Monday. I need to do a couple quick practice problems. On Monday, we're going to have a little quizzy poo.
Do we have homework tonight?
Yes, you have homework every night.
Yeah, we had homework last night.
That's right. So quiet, we got a couple more minutes. Let's use it productively here. So, question number 1. Sketch.
Where are you supposed to put
this? Write anywhere you want. This is your practice clues. You don't even have to write it down. But this is what I'm going to ask you to do on Monday. So sketch, and by that I mean on a number line. I might even draw the number line for you. What's that going to look like? I sketch that.
It's going to look like a closed circle.
I'm going to have something at negative 1 and something at 2, right?
Close circle.
And then meet in the middle.
And the circle at negative 1 will have to be closed because the bracket is closed.
Yeah.
And I'm going to shade in the twin. Right?
Yeah.
All right, now, write as an interval. So in other words, this is interval notation. So we're going backwards now. What's that going to look like in this notation?
Parentheses.
Going to have a bracket for the 6.
Infinity.
And an infinity and a parentheses because infinities always get parentheses. Right?
Right.
Okay, one more.
I think it's so hard to draw.
We're at 3 questions, and I'll look just like this. Okay? 3 questions. Here we go. Here's the 3rd one. Simplify.
Oh, no. How long is a quizzy poo?
3 questions. I just told you.
Hi. Brittany, pay attention.
Here we go. Here we go. Simplify. So these are our exponents. Take it slow, 1 step at a time. What do you have 2 right there?
Keep it down.
Just leave it there. There's nothing to cancel it on top, right? So it's just staying. All right, what about my x's?
It's going down.
I got 2 of them.
You got 2 of them, John.
Over 5 of them.
X3 cubed.
So I'm going to have 3 extras
on the bottom.
Uh-oh, negative.
He's
coming down. There's 7 of them down here.
Oh.
And I'm breaking down three more. So there's going to be 10 of them. Now stop. What's on the top?
One on the top.
All right. Wait. Whoa. Stop. It's Friday.
What does that mean?
That means you do not leave the room until you get a hug from your teacher.
Yes.
Up here so you can take a picture, move the keys, and you can take a picture of that.